Glad to be here. Excited to hear. Starting a new series today called FAQ, Frequently Asked Questions. All the questions you've always had about God, the church, or sin, but that you've been too afraid to ask. Yeah, it's going to be fun. We're not going to dodge the questions that you have. We're not going to skirt around the issues. We're going to address your questions head on. Is that cool with you guys? Can we do that? Because many of y'all have submitted questions via email or written me a note and said, Pastor, I have this question. We're going to talk about them. A book was recently released called I Sold My Soul on eBay. And it was written by an atheist. He went around to a number of churches and he was writing in the book things that he liked about the churches that he visited, things that he didn't like. And one of the things this atheist said he did not like about the churches that he visited is that he felt like they were not answering his questions. That there was never a forum or some kind of environment that he could go into and ask questions. I mean, he wasn't even sure if God existed. He wasn't sure that Jesus came back from the dead. He had questions, and he felt like a lot of the churches that he visited dodged the questions. And I just want you to know that in experienced life, we are open to questions. We're open to you coming into this place with doubts, with issues. You're not sure what to believe about something. We embrace the questions. And so we're going to spend at least 6 weeks every year answering your questions. Is that cool? And we're going to start today and we're going to go for 6 weeks. Now, let me tell you kind of what's going to happen here. This book, God's Word, is going to be our standard of truth. It's going to be our authority. And where the Bible speaks clearly about one of the questions that you have, I will stand beside it and I will not waver a bit, regardless of if it offends you or me. And I don't know if you've read the Bible before, but if you read it, it will offend you at times because it will call you out. If the Bible does not speak clearly about your question or about an issue, I will look for principles to apply. I'll tell you what I think, and you're welcome to disagree. Remember, we can disagree on the non-essentials. You always have the right to be wrong. But in experienced life, we will choose to major on the majors and minor on the minors. So let's get right into your questions. Many people ask questions about whether certain behaviors are sinful or not, right? You've had these. I mean, people call and say, Pastor, is what I'm doing here, is this sinful? What does the Bible say about this action or this behavior that I have a question about? And so we're going to address those the next 2 weeks. But before we get started, I get kind of thirsty, to be honest, when I'm up here. And so y'all don't mind if I grab a drink, right, to have up here with me between questions. Is that cool? Anybody mind? Can I? Okay, thanks. Okay, much better. Okay, so... Thank you. I mean, serious, because, you know, you need something when you're up here, you know, having to speak in front of this many people, okay? And but here's the deal. We're going to take a poll real quick because some of y'all are like, oh, dear Lord. And I would just say, welcome to church, all right? But anyways, here we're taking a poll. We're going to be honest, okay, about just some of these questions that you have, all right? Yes, this is not fake. All right, this is a Bud Light in my hand. Tim went to get it this week, okay? Not fake. Here's a question I have, though. How many of you guys would say, Pastor, I've got no problem with that. If I knew that you drank, I've got no problem with that at all. Pastor, got no problem. How many guys? Okay, thank you for the freedom. Thank you very much. How many of you guys, though, would say, Pastor, oh, makes me feel a little bit uncomfortable, a little bit awkward, especially if you drank in church. That would make me feel a little bit weird. Okay, thank you very much. Next question. How many of you guys, and be honest, how many of you guys would say you like the taste of beer? Just be honest. Yeah, it's an acquired taste, right? Like urine. You know, you drink enough of it. You drink enough of it and you start to like it, right? That's what some of you guys have found. So here's the question that we're asking and that you ask me all the time. You know who you are, all right? Is drinking a sin? Is it a sin to drink? Now, we all have different backgrounds in this room. I understand that. So another poll. How many of you guys were taught, either in your home or your church growing up, that it is always a sin to drink? It is, yeah. Yeah, always a sin. Okay, how many of you guys were taught growing up that when you're of age, it's okay if you drink? Not a big deal. Okay, here's the question. Your opinion, my opinion, doesn't matter. Question we're asking today is, what does the Bible say? Look on the back of your card. We're going to talk about it. You can follow me. Is drinking a sin? I'm going to shoot straight with you. Not going to beat around the bush. Here we go. First point. Mark it down from the Bible. Getting drunk is a sin. Straight up. getting drunk is a sin. Listen to the Bible in Ephesians chapter 5. Write down this verse, Ephesians 5, verse 18. Bible says, don't be drunk with wine because that will ruin your life. So what's God saying? Hey, that's not best for you. It could potentially damage or even ruin your life if you get drunk. So the Bible makes it clear. Hey, getting drunk is clearly a sin. Second point, and this may surprise some of you. Drinking, mark it down, drinking without getting drunk is not a sin. Some of you guys are like, praise Jesus. All right, thank you, Pastor. Makes me feel better. Drinking alcohol without getting drunk is not a sin if you are of age. Let me qualify it by saying that. Not a sin. Listen to what the Bible says. Paul, who wrote, by the way, Paul wrote 2/3 of our New Testament. Listen to what Paul says to Timothy, one of his disciples. In 1 Timothy 5, verse 23, Paul says, hey, Timothy, don't drink only water. You ought to drink a little wine for the sake of your stomach because you are sick so often. So Paul told Timothy, hey, sometimes you may need to drink. Go for it, saying there's nothing inherently wrong with alcohol. John chapter 2, Jesus is at a wedding and they run out of the good stuff. So what does Jesus do? He changes water into what? He changes water into wine. That's Jesus. So I don't think that you can argue from the New Testament that drinking without getting drunk is a sin. I think it's clear drinking without getting drunk is not a sin if you are of age. But let's ask a different question, okay? Let me read you this verse. We're going to do a lot of Bible in this series because what you want to know, what I want to know is God's opinion. What does God say? You don't need another man's opinion about the issues of life. You need God's opinion. Here we go. Everything is permissible for me, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 12. Everything is permissible for me, Paul says, but not everything is beneficial. Did you catch that? Everything may be permissible for me that God doesn't say is a sin. Everything may be permissible, but not everything is beneficial. And then he says, everything's permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. So what's he saying? Some things may be permissible, but the question that you have to ask and the question that I have to ask is it beneficial? So here's the big question. Is drinking alcohol beneficial for you? Is drinking alcohol beneficial for me as a spiritual leader in this church and in this community? I want you to be the judge. I want to show you a quick video. You guys will know this pastor. This is of a pastor and his staff. He's a pastor in Oklahoma City. Y'all remember the Satan videos? It's the pastor on those. Craig Rochelle is his name. He was asking his congregation, same question. Is drinking alcohol beneficial for us as ministers? I want you to see the video. You be the judge.
Question I believe God would have you ask is drinking alcohol really beneficial for you? Is drinking alcohol beneficial for me? Why don't you be the judge? Alrighty. The back porch, beautiful day. Yeah, God is good. I'm kind of worn out though. What about a beer? Beer? Maybe just one. Yeah. I think I know where one is. Let me go look back here. I think there's one right here. Beer.
Hey guys, let's go spend some time with Craig.
Yeah, you know, usually about this time, he's probably sitting on his back porch studying his Bible.
Yeah, maybe he'll do a Bible study with us.
Yeah, let's go spend some time with Craig.
How'd it go at your campuses this week?
We had like 5,000 people at the Oklahoma City campus.
Oh, God! Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. 2,600 at the Edmond campus.
Stuart had 720 people.
Oh. 400 in Tulsa, man, and three people raised their hand.
Did they raise their hand for another beer?
Hey, Daddy, can I have a drink?
No, buddy, I'm sorry. This is just for grown-ups.
Bible says don't get drunk on wine.
Oh, I'm not drunk.
Why are you
I'm a Pastor T.T.
You're the man! No, you're the man! No, you're the man.
He's right. Oh, yeah.
Guys, yeah!
Welcome to Life Church. May I serve you?
You want some meat? With some meat?
Hey, man, isn't it awesome to be at Life Church? This is incredible.
Yeah, it is too cool. You know, and the best thing is being part of the best campus, of course, you know.
Well, man, you're not a part of Tulsa. What are you talking about?
I don't want to be a part of Tulsa either.
Man, you need to shut up right now, man.
God is on our side.
Shut up!
Here on the crash scene, three people have been injured, one person confirmed dead, and of the critically injured, an 18-month-old toddler. At this time, no names have been released. We're not able to get close to the crash site, but we do know the jaws of life are being used to pull passengers out of the cars. Police aren't releasing a lot of information, but they do say they're investigating whether alcohol played a role in this crash.
Stop. Let's rewind the tape for a moment and ask ourselves, when did it all go wrong? Was it when someone innocent got hurt as a result of alcohol? Was it when the partying got a little bit out of hand? Was it when a parent sent a confusing message to a child? Or was it when I opened up the very first drink? Everything may be permissible, but not everything is beneficial. Remember, the Bible says, be very careful, however, how you exercise your freedom. Don't ever let it become a stumbling block for the weak. Mm-hmm. Hey, bartender, could I get that drink?
Cherry limeade with extra cherries.
So could my freedom as a pastor to drink, which I do have, cause somebody else to stumble? I think so. And so for me, I have chosen that drinking alcohol would not be beneficial for me. In fact, it could be potentially harmful for people all around me. Personal conviction. Some other people that I don't think it would be beneficial for is if when you drink alcohol, you get drunk, usually you have trouble controlling it, then drinking alcohol leads you to sin, and I would say it's not beneficial for you. If you say you're an alcoholic or you struggle with alcoholism, I would say drinking alcohol is probably not beneficial for you either. But many of you drink socially. Many of you drink, and you drink in moderation, and I think the Bible would tell you that is just fine. It is not a sin. The question you have to ask is it beneficial for you? And we may come to different conclusions based on where we're at in life. Some of you may say, hey, it's beneficial for me because I can drink in moderation. Others would say, I don't think for where I'm at in life, it's probably beneficial for me. And that's just fine. In experienced life, this is a minor issue. Some people come here and they drink and they can control it, and that's great. Some people come and they say, hey, I've really got an issue with it. It's not beneficial for me. That is great as well. The question you and I have to ask is it beneficial for us? Because the Bible clearly says if you are of age, it is not a sin to drink. Fair enough? On first question, are we good? Can we move on? Can we do a second question? Let's do a second one. We're doing three today. Second question is this. Is it wrong to get a tattoo or a body piercing? Yeah, I've been asked that. Is it wrong to get a tattoo or body piercing? Before we address the question, though, I felt like I should ask the leadership of our church whether or not they have tattoos. So, I'm going to show you a video. I'm going to introduce you to somebody you probably know. And then the screen's going to come up that's going to say tattoo or no tattoo. And based on how they look and what they do, I want you to holler out either tattoo, you think they have one, or no tattoo, there's no way. You ready? Leadership of the church, let's go.
All right, tell me your name and what you do.
Hey, my name's Tim Beal, and I do student ministry here for Experience Life.
What do you guys think? Tattoo or no tattoo?
Tim, do you have a tattoo?
No.
Liar.
Yes, I do. I have one on my arm.
And what is that tattoo of?
It is,
What are these?
This is the Greek symbol for the Trinity. This is Hebrew for choose this day who you'll serve. And then, I've got a scroll that says freedom and a scroll that says slavery. Just as a constant reminder, you wake up every day and you get to choose who you're going to serve. You can serve freedom of Christ or slavery of the world.
Tell me your name and what you do.
My name is Brandon Gwynn, and I'm the worship pastor.
Tattoo or no tattoo? What do y'all think? Brandon, do you have a tattoo?
No, I don't have a tattoo.
Why don't you have a tattoo?
I'm a sissy.
Tell me your name and what you do.
My name's Justin Atkins. I'm the executive pastor here at Experience Life.
Tattoo or no tattoo? What do you guys think? Justin, do you have a tattoo?
I do not have a tattoo.
Tell me your name and what you do.
I'm Missy Gore, and I'm the children's director.
What do y'all think? Children's director. Tattoo or no tattoo? Missy, do you have a tattoo?
No, I don't.
And I set up at the church.
I'm Nikki Hall. I'm a dental hygienist, and I help with the children.
What do y'all think? Tattoo or no tattoo? Okay, Nikki, do you have a tattoo? No tattoo. And Chuck?
Yes.
You do have a tattoo. Can you show us? And tell us what it is.
It's Calvin.
Tell me your name and what you do.
I'm Jordan. I'm a student at LCU. And I'm set up.
What do you think? Full beard. Tattoo or no tattoo? Jordan, do you have a tattoo?
No.
Any reason why not?
They're expensive.
What's your name? What do you do?
I'm Chrissy Harrelson, mother of five. I work part-time for Earl, and I sell cabbie clothes, and I'm a lifehouse leader.
What do y'all think? Mother of five, tattoo or no tattoo? So, Chrissy, do you have a tattoo?
Yes.
Is it something we can see?
No.
All right, tell me your name and what you do.
My name's Jimmy Ashford. I'm a dental technician and a lifehouse leader at Experience Life.
What do you think? Dental technician, tattoo or no tattoo? All right, Jimmy. Do you have a tattoo?
I have two.
Can we see one of them?
Yeah.
And tell us what that is of.
That is a crown of thorns.
Tell me your name and what you do.
My name is Stephanie, and I work at FastPay Payroll Services, and I'm also a lifehouse group leader.
This is Stephanie. What do you think? Tattoo or no tattoo? Stephanie, do you have a tattoo?
Yes.
Is it one that you can show us?
Yes.
All right, let's see it.
It's of a rose.
So if it's not okay, we might be in some trouble with the leadership of our church, all right? But my name is Chris. I'm the pastor of this church. What do you think? Tattoo or no tattoo? Don't let me down now. Tattoo or no tattoo? Tell me. What do you think? How many of you guys do not think I have a tattoo? What? How many of you guys do think I have a tattoo? Thank y'all very much. I'll tell y'all some other time. All right, so I do not have a tattoo, but my reason for not having one is because I don't like needles, okay? So question, is it wrong to get a tattoo or a body piercing? Short answer, according to the Bible, is it wrong? I would say in most cases it is not wrong. And so you say, okay, then why do some people say that it is? I had this great, great, great grandma that she quoted to me some passage from the Bible about how my tattoo was going to send me to hell or something. And what was she quoting to me? And so let me read you in the Bible where it says something similar to this. In Leviticus 19, verse 28, it says, "Do not cut your bodies for the dead, and do not mark your skin with tattoos. I am the Lord." Like, Pastor, that sounds to me like my tattoo is a bad thing, because it just said that God doesn't want me to get a tattoo. Remember that this was written to the Israelites at a time where the majority of the people that got tattoos were pagan. And the reason they got the tattoo was a symbol of the fact that they belonged to a cult. Now, is that the reason that most people get tattoos today? If it was, I would say it's probably still not a good idea, but I don't think that's the reason most people get tattoos. Also, this Old Testament command is not reaffirmed in the New Testament, so I do not think it is wrong in most cases. Now, here are some cases where I think it may be questionable. If your tattoo is of a blasphemous or inappropriate image, I'd say it's probably wrong. If you get a tattoo on your body somewhere that says, Jesus is not Lord, I would say that's not a good thing. You get a tattoo on your body of a naked person, yeah, I say probably not the best idea. If you get a body piercing on a part of your body that would be inappropriate to display to the whole world, and that's what you intend to do, I would say not a good idea for that body piercing. And last but not least, students, if you're sitting here going, I'm telling my parents when I get home what that pastor said, Bible says if mama or daddy says no and you're still under their authority, what must you do? Honor your father and mother. And all the parents in the room said, amen. All right. So just in case, students, you're going to go home and say, I heard that. I love that preacher. And he said, I could get a tattoo. No, mom and dad say no. Sorry. So in most cases, though, most cases, I would say it is not wrong. Now, just a general word of caution. If you're dating somebody and you really like them a lot, and you're thinking about maybe going down for their birthday or something and letting them watch you get a tattoo of their name on your body, I would recommend against that, because if you don't marry that person and you marry somebody else and they find that tattoo, you're going to have some explaining to do. And I'm sure you won't want to explain why you got a tattoo and you're only dating of that person's name. So caution, word of caution there. Now, Tim was telling me a story. Tim, our youth pastor, tell me a story about his youth group, and they went on trips each summer to youth camp, and they had a bus driver one year, and he had like tattoos all over his body. And so the students were like, that is so cool. And so they're up by the bus driver looking at his tattoos and asking him about them. And one of the sponsors of the trip goes up to see what they're doing, and the sponsor notices that the guy has on his forearms tattoos of naked ladies. And so the sponsor says, kids, get back to the back of the bus, you know, get away from there. This is purity time, you know, youth camp. This is a church, all right? And so the kids, they want to talk to him, though. They want to get to know this guy. They don't know if he has a relationship with Jesus or not, and they're on fire for God. They'd love to help him come to know Christ if he doesn't. And so later in the trip, they're talking to this guy. And believe it or not, they share the good news of the gospel with this guy, and he gets saved. The bus driver gives his life to Christ. Unbelievable. Well, next year, he was their bus driver again. And they went up to the front of the bus again to look at the tattoos, and they noticed that he had tattooed bikinis over the over the naked ladies on his arms, because now that he's a believer, he wants to honor God with his body, you know? And so he thought bikinis would be better than nakedness, and I would have to agree. And so his life was definitely changed when he trusted Christ. So is it okay to get a tattoo or a body piercing? I would say in most cases, absolutely, it is okay. We good? Question number two, we good? Can we go to number three? Y'all got time? Y'all need to go. Y'all got somewhere to be? Another hour? All right, okay. Question number three, and then we're done. I get asked this a lot. Question number three, this is going to hit home, so get ready, buckle up. Question number three, is it okay to cuss? Okay, I get asked this. Doesn't really matter what you do or what I do or what you think or what I think. Question is, what does the Bible say? Is it okay to cuss? Some people are like, no. How many of you guys were taught growing up that it is always wrong to cuss? Don't you use those words. How many of you guys were taught growing up, hey, if you cuss on occasion, not a big deal. I mean, it's just, yeah, okay. What does the Bible say? I'm going to read you some Bible. Get ready. Colossians 3, verse 8. But now is the time to get rid of anger and rage, malicious behavior, slander, and dirty language. Ephesians 4:29. Don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. James 1:26. If anyone considers himself religious and yet does not keep a tight rein on his tongue, listen to this, he deceives himself and his religion is worthless. It's the Bible. Offends me too. James 3:9-10. Sometimes the tongue praises our Lord and Father. Sometimes it curses those who have been made in the image of God. And so blessing and cursing come pouring out of the same mouth. Surely, my brothers and sisters, James says, this is not right. So I'm sure most of you are not surprised by the biblical stance on this issue, but question, is it okay to cuss? Bible would say no. I mean, you're praising God one minute with your tongue. Oh, God, I'm going to church on Sunday. I'm singing songs. Yeah, I'm listening to the preacher. And God, I want you to bless my family. And the next minute, you're using your tongue that God gave you to say a curse word. You know what the Bible says that is? Hypocrisy. Hypocrisy. So guess how many hypocrites are probably in this room today? Probably all of us. Because all of us have praised God with our tongue and also cursed with the same tongue. I mean, it makes sense, right? We honor God one minute with our tongue, and then we dishonor him in the next minute by saying things that he's told us not to say. Matthew 12, 36. Men will have to give an account. This gets me. Listen to this. Men will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken. How long is your account going to be? I think mine's probably going to be pretty long, but you know what God's saying? Is that the words that come out of our mouth matter. They matter to God because you know what's an indication of? What's going on in our heart. And so the Bible says one day you will give an account and I will give an account for every careless word that we have spoken. God says don't speak carelessly. Somebody called me once. Was struggling with this. He knew it was wrong. He wasn't trying to defend himself. He wasn't trying to act like the Bible didn't clearly say that it was wrong to cuss. And he called and he said, I just have a question for you, Pastor. And I said, sure. And he said, I struggle with this. I say words on occasion that I know I shouldn't say. Here was his question. So am I still acceptable to God? Good question, right? Meaning, you know, if I say a word and then I don't repent or don't confess it and then I die, I mean, am I going to hell because I struggle with this? I mean, what's the deal with me? Am I still acceptable to God even though I'm struggling with cussing? And I said, can I ask you a simple question? He said, yeah. I said, has there ever been a time in your life where you've given your life to Jesus? He said, yeah. And he told me about the time. He told me about how he put his faith in Christ and how that changed his life. And so then I told him, if you've done that, then your acceptability before God has nothing to do with what you do or don't do, but with what Christ did for you on the cross 2,000 years ago. He said, can you say that again? I said, doesn't matter what you do or don't do. If you put your faith in Jesus, you're acceptable before God because of Jesus. Because you serve and have believed in a perfect Savior. And by the end of that conversation, what is he doing? He's crying. He can't believe. I mean, he doesn't believe he should be acceptable before God because he knows he's sinned. He knows he's broken God's law. He doesn't deserve heaven. He knows that in his heart. But what he didn't realize is that relationship with Jesus sealed the deal and that he was acceptable not because of how good he was, that God didn't care about that, but he cared about whether or not he had put his faith in Jesus. Guess what, guys? That's good news, and that set him free. And some of you say, okay, so then I guess if that's the case, and you just sin all you want, I mean, who really cares? Was that his attitude after that conversation? Absolutely not. Because of all God had done for him, what did he want to do? He was compelled to continue to struggle and confess and repent and do whatever he had to do to stop using that kind of language. Why? Because of that good news, that it was about grace, that it was about his relationship with Jesus and not about what he did or did not do. It compelled him to want to follow Jesus, not rebel against him. And surely because of all Jesus has done for you and for me, it's not a lot for him to ask that we honor him with our tongue, is it? Is it a lot for God to ask for me and you to use language that honors him? I don't think so. I mean, he sent Jesus to take the nails that had your name written on them. Those weren't his nails. He was innocent. He was perfect. He didn't do anything wrong. That's what you deserved. That's what I deserve, to die on that cross. And he came and he gave his life for you and he gave his life for me and he rose from the dead on the third day in victory over sin and death. Is it a lot for him to ask after he's done all that for us to honor him with our tongue? I don't think so. And that convicts me. Don't know if it convicts you. But Bible says one day you will give an account for every careless word you have spoken. God gave us our tongue. He gave us the ability to speak and to use words. Don't you want to honor him with the gift that he's given you? So, question, is it okay to cuss? Bible clearly says, no, it is not okay. And when you struggle with it, What should you do? Should you question your stance before God? Absolutely not if you're a follower of Jesus. What should you do? The Bible says just confess and repent and remember that Christ gave his life for you so that you could be forgiven and he wants you to follow him. That's the deal. So here's my challenge for you today. After you've heard some of these things, I mean, because some of you are listening going, okay, I mean, that's me. I'm there, you know. I know I'm a sinner. I mean, I'm the pastor of this church, and I'll tell you that I am totally imperfect. But here's my challenge for you. When you have big questions like this about whether or not things are sinful, don't go poll your neighborhood. Don't go poll the people that you work with. Don't even poll your family. Open up a Bible, because there's really only one opinion that matters, and that's whose? That's God's opinion. And so if you want to know if a certain behavior or a certain action is sinful, I would challenge you to look in God's word, and it will tell you there. And so some of you sit here today and you go, okay, thanks. I mean, I've heard this and this helps me to know what the Bible says, but I'm messed up. Like, Pastor, what you're talking about, the drunkenness thing, I bet you most people in this room have been drunk at least once before. I don't know that most people in this room have tattoos of naked people on their bodies, but I'm sure the drunk thing, I'm sure the cussing thing, that all of us at times have struggled with that as well. So the question you may have is the same question the guy had for me. So am I acceptable to God? I mean, I struggle with sin. I'm a sinner, Pastor. I already know that. I'm not perfect. The only question that matters is, what have you done with Jesus? And if you've put your faith and your trust in Jesus, if you've received him as your Lord and Savior, you're acceptable, because he's a great Savior, even though you're a great sinner. And your stance before God never changes. He accepts you because of Christ, not because we've been good enough to enter his heaven, because none of us have been. Now you say, but doesn't that kind of affect my fellowship with God? Sure. Your stance doesn't change. Your eternity doesn't change. You're heaven bound if you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. But the Bible also says that God disciplines those he loves. So if you're struggling with sin, you're walking away from God, he's going to discipline you just like a parent would a child, so that you come back to God, because he wants you to be close. He wants you to be near him. So it affects your fellowship. He wants you to be close. But it doesn't affect your stance. And so you and I can live in freedom. We can live in freedom knowing that we're acceptable to God based on what Jesus has done, not based on what we do or don't do. Is that good news to anybody besides me? Is that really great news to anybody besides me? It set him free, that news. If you read the book of Romans, it will set you free. It's not about works. Does God want us to be good? Sure, but that won't get us to heaven. God wants us to be saved. God wants us to be forgiven. That's what gets you to heaven. So I'm sure you've asked the question before, am I acceptable? You are, if you put your faith in Jesus. So if you leave this place over the next couple of weeks convicted, hey, join the club. All of us will. That's okay. I don't want you to leave, though, feeling condemned. Jesus came and he died for you so that you wouldn't feel condemned, but so that you would receive his forgiveness into your life and then live in freedom and be compelled to live for him and be his follower, because you know that living for him brings extreme joy, purpose, meaning, and fulfillment in life. It's exciting. You know, in our day, it seems like a lot of times people don't want to call sin sin. You know why I think that is? It's because we want to think that we're really good, that we're close to perfect, I guess. But did you know that that's not the attitude that God wants us to have? To claim that we're so good, or one day we're going to get to heaven because we've been good enough. That's what most people tell me when I ask how they're going to get to heaven. They think they're going to be good enough. We want to think that we're good, so we don't want to call sin sin, especially if we're doing it. You know, but we can call it that, because we know what Jesus has done for us, that he's come and that he's paid the price, that he's been our sacrifice, so that by trusting in him, we can be forgiven. And so the attitude that God wants you to have in me is this: Jesus, I know, maybe compared to my neighbor, I'm really good, but compared to you, compared to your standard of good, I am nothing. I mean, I'm a nobody. I think most of us in this room would say, man, we've broken like every commandment, most of them. You say, well, I hadn't murdered anybody. Jesus said, you've been angry with your brother in your heart, you're a murderer in your heart. I hadn't committed adultery. Jesus says, you lust, you commit adultery in your heart. Broken like all of God's commands. God, I'm not that good, but I believe that you sent Jesus to pay my fine, and that he was good. He was perfect. And so no longer am I trusting in myself to be right with you. I'm just going to trust in Jesus. I'm going to do the best I can to follow you. And when you reveal that there is sin in my life, I'll confess it, I'll repent, and I'll begin to walk with you once again. He offers you freedom. Let Christ live through you. Don't be in bondage by fear of, is what's God going to do with me? If you put your faith in Jesus, you're a child of God. You will go to heaven. He accepts you not because of you, but because of Jesus. And that's really, really good.